Shackle. He is a professor of pomology at UC Davis. His lab studies the impact of tree and vine water status on productivity and water relations and physiological activity of the fruit. He also does extensive work on utilizing sensors to monitor and manage irrigation decisions. He teaches environmental physiology of cultivated plants and upper division soil plant water relations. One of my few regrets while I was at UC Davis was that I didn't take his soil plant water relations class. So I have to get that some other ways, this being one of them. He's the recipient of several awards, including National Excellence in Multi-State Research Award for research he did on sustainable irrigation management. And in 2008, he was named National Academy's Education Fellow in the Life Sciences. He's a well-loved professor, and we're really lucky to have him here today with us. So thanks, Ken.
Okay, thank you, Margaret. That was way too long of an introduction, but I'll let that slide. So I appreciate that this is a very informal thing. I'm really good with informal. So just pipe up if you have any questions. But what I'm gonna talk about is how to ask the plant when it needs water. So if you think about a leaf as a photosynthetic factory, which I am sure everyone in this room understands, then you think about the plant as just a collection of those photosynthetic factories. And one of the most important rules about plant function, in my opinion, kind of the most important rule, because I'm a water guy, is plants use a lot of water. The reason why plants use a lot of water is because water is lost through stomata, and the stomata are what you would call the doors to the photosynthetic factory. And basically, like any other factory, it can't work if the doors aren't open. So basically, when plants open the doors to the photosynthetic factory, they lose water. And this is unavoidable from a plant's perspective because the atmosphere is usually pretty dry. And so the second rule that follows from the first rule is you have to take up water from the soil to replace the water that's lost. I'm not sure if everybody knows this, but a plant, you know, most plants in midsummer can lose their entire fresh weight equivalent in water every day. So it's a lot of water that needs to be replaced. And of course, that all takes place through the roots. Now, the consequences of this are very important for plants, and that is that basically the tree is in the middle of a sort of a giant tug of war. The atmosphere evaporates water very well, and it can just keep evaporating water all the time unless it's 100% humidity, which it very rarely is. But if the stomata are closed, then it can tug all it wants, but it's not going to pull water out of the plant. However, when the doors open up, then the atmosphere can pull a lot of water, and that creates a suction. And basically, in order for the leaves to get water from the stem that they're attached to, the leaf has to suck harder than the stem is sucking in order to pull the water out of it. And of course, the stem has to then suck from the branch, and the branch has to suck from the bigger branches all the way down to the trunk and to the roots, and they suck out of the soil. So this is the giant sucking sound that you may have heard Ross Perot talk about if you're old enough to remember Ross Perot. So everything is about suction in the plant. Even when the soil is wet, the roots have to suck water out of the soil, and that takes some suction. But then when the soil gets dry, it starts sucking back pretty hard. And so this is why plants respond to dry soil conditions by having more suction in them. Well, when plants get more suction in them, what happens is that the cells get water sucked out of them because of the suction in the plant. And the most obvious sign of this is wilting. So the reason why wilting occurs is because the cells are normally inflated with water pressure called turgor pressure. And when they get sucked on too hard, that water starts to leave, and then they get not inflated. And so the amount of suction on the water in the plant is a very important measure of how water stress the plant feels. And since I'm a plant physiologist, I'm always concerned about how the plant feels. My brother Roy tells everybody that I torture plants for a living, which of course, I guess this would be sort of torture, but I'm always interested in how the plant is feeling. And in order to know how it's feeling, sometimes you have to torture it a little bit. Anyway, this suction is called water potential in scientific terms, but it's basically just a pressure that is negative. Okay, instead of a pressure, it's a suction. So there is a way to measure this pressure, and it's called the pressure chamber method, or it's also called the pressure bomb. I don't want to go into the reasons why it's called a bomb, but it's basically like a blood pressure cuff for a plant, where you can tell whether this water that's in the plant is under a lot of suction or under a little suction. When it's under a lot of suction and it takes a lot of pressure to push water out of the plant, then that means the tree is under a lot of suction at that time. And that may be a bad thing or it may be a good thing, depending on what you want that plant to be doing at that time. So what we do is we put a bag on a leaf. Normally when a leaf is not bagged and it is exposed to the sun, it's sucking harder than the stem because it's demanding water to make up for the water that it's losing. But as soon as you put a bag on it, especially when it's in the shade like this, then the suction on that leaf just simply becomes whatever the suction on the stem is. And there is suction in the stem because all these other leaves are still sucking water. So if you leave it there for a while, 10 minutes is all it takes to leave it there. Normally what we do is we put a bag on one plant and then move to another plant, move to another plant. By the time we're done bagging all the leaves we want to measure, we come back to the first one and it's been on there for 10 minutes. You can harvest that leaf, put it inside a chamber, and this particular chamber just works like a bicycle pump. Since we're in Davis, we like bicycles and bicycle pumps. And what you're looking at, but there's a lot of different pressure chambers and they all do the same job. What you're looking for is you're watching the veins that are in the plant, the xylem that's in the plant, in that petiole that's sticking out. And all you need to do is raise the pressure until you see water come out, which is pretty obvious. It looks a little bit like that. And sometimes if you want, you can go back and forth. You can release the pressure a little bit and raise the pressure a little bit. And if you find a fairly narrow range where that pressure is able to push water out, then that's the value of the suction that's on the plant. So that's pretty much the pressure chamber. Are there any questions about that before I go on?
Is this a tool that, how commonly used is this tool, or is this a tool that you're suggesting folks use in their orchards?
Ah, this is a very good question. Thank you for asking it. It is a very simple and easy to use tool, in my opinion. Now, there's been a lot of pushback from some growers saying, I don't want to have to go out to the orchard, or I think this is too difficult, or it's a scientific instrument and I'm not a scientist. But really, it's about as easy as measuring somebody's blood pressure. And the tools, as I said here, there are a lot of different tools and they all have different bells and whistles. The cheapest one pretty much is the one you pump up by hand. And if you like exercise, that's kind of fun. But these others are powered by gas or a nitrogen gas or CO2 or something like that. And they certainly were invented early on as a scientific research tool. But yes, this is a very practical measurement, and there's a lot of growers that use it. I think as we go ahead in time, more and more people will start realizing that they're able to tell whether their plants are under stress, and that is a very important piece of information related to how they're going to manage their irrigation. Is that okay?
Yeah, one other question. How many samples would you need to take?
Oh, very good. Boy, we're getting into it. Okay, this is great. Let me get back to that question in a second, okay? Okay?
Yes.
Okay, so one thing is that if the air is hot or dry, then even if the plant is under fully irrigated conditions, wet soil conditions, so the soil's not sucking back, then the weather affects what the reading will be. So these are values that would apply to, I think, most prunus actually, but we've confirmed them in prune and almond. And that is that, you know, if it's 60% humidity and 60 degrees out, then you'd get around 5 bars. A bar is a unit of pressure. It's equal to 14.5 atmosphere, PSI. Anyway, so it's actually a lot of PSI, but if it's humid and cold, then you don't have much tension in the plant. If it's hot and dry, it can, you know, more than double the number that you would expect. And this is all under fully irrigated conditions. So the weather, so what we call the baseline water potential. So we call this stem water potential, midday stem water potential, because the leaf is bagged and it's equilibrating with the stem. The same thing applies to tomatoes or anything else. The weather is important to know whether that reading that you get on that day, like 6.6, if that's the day, if that day it's 80 and, out and 40% humidity, your plants are fully irrigated. They don't need any water. Okay. They may need it tomorrow, but at least they'll tell you they don't need it today if they're already at that baseline. Now, the field variability about how many plants you need to measure to get an idea is a very interesting question. Typically in trees, we use one leaf per tree. And I know people have sort of done a bit of a survey of their orchard and found the average tree and then just use one tree per irrigation set. If you have an irrigation set, let's say you irrigate, you know, 5 acres at a time, then you're going to have to make one decision for that 5 acres. So if you want to find out if there's a dry streak, a sandy streak, or a clay streak that doesn't need so much water, that's all very interesting information. But if it's not going to influence your decision about when to irrigate, you don't need to measure all that variability. It might help you to measure that variability in the beginning to understand it, but basically you can probably look at the field and know where the big plants are, the vigorous plants and the small plants, and you've already made your decision about if you're irrigating to the driest spot or the wettest spot. I suspect this is an area that's still kind of open to question. But as I said, there are plenty of examples where growers use one tree per irrigation set because they've determined that's a pretty average tree. And I suspect that the same thing would be true for tomatoes or any other crop. Everybody, is that okay? Hearing any, yes, anybody? Is Bueller out there? Okay. So these baseline values are telling you if your tree is at this value, then the soil is not limiting and you have no business irrigating. Okay, so one issue that I've had pretty much my whole career with the idea of ET, which I'm sure everybody's familiar with, is it's a great engineering principle, and everybody needs to understand that the weather drives evaporation and that water that's evaporating from a crop depends a lot on the weather. But the question, and there's plenty of resources out there to help you schedule irrigations based on ET, but I, as a plant physiologist, always say, okay, fine, but you know, how does the plant feel? So here's an example of almond trees after 1 year of growth out in winters, and quite a long time ago. And we grew these trees and only applied about half of the water requirements that we calculated based on the tree size and all this stuff about reference ET. We had, at that time, we had and still have crop coefficients for almonds. Okay, so these trees for one-year-old almond trees look pretty good, actually. Their stem water potential measured about 15 bars over the course of the season. Baseline values would be about 8 for this area. And these grew pretty well, but the reason why they grew pretty well was because the soil out there in winters is fantastic. It's deep, and we had some pretty good winter rains. So the fact that we gave these trees 50%, you know, didn't bother them much. You can see they grew very well. Well, but we're a scientist, okay? So we wanted to put 100% of calculated ET on it. And you can see we have a better crop of native vegetation, AKA weeds here, but the trees grew a lot better. And their water potential was actually closer to the baseline. So less stressed with 100% ET. But of course, we're a scientist, so we want to put on more than 100% ET. Now, these trees ended up getting 300% of ET. And I'm not advocating that everybody puts on 300% of ET. But what I am saying is these trees were at baseline. And they grew really well. These were kind of giant-sized almond trees for 1 year of growth. Nobody had ever seen trees this big for after 1 year of growth. So the fact is that the trees responded to this water. And if you're growing an orchard in the early stages, you want to get trees to fill the space quickly. So for a young orchard, maybe baseline is a good reference and they need to stay near baseline. Well, what about a mature crop of almonds or any other tree? So for instance, this is an example of walnuts. So I'm just giving some examples here where we've used the pressure chamber to kind of fine tune irrigation and what we found about it. Now, walnuts, I would say, are the poster child for a fruit or nut tree that is very sensitive to water stress. It's native to very wet areas, and every walnut grower will tell you, you never want to short your walnut trees for water. So you can see these are growing out by a river, and this was in Tehama, and the grower always noticed that these trees look very stressed at harvest. So walnuts are harvested in kind of October, September, October, and they have to turn the water off so they can get in and harvest the trees. So all nut trees pretty much have the same issue that water is cut off at near harvest to get in. And they could see that the leaves were flagging and the trees didn't look very healthy. So they were worried. And their question was, well, okay, maybe we need to irrigate more. Maybe they're running out of water at the end of the season and we need to put more in that bank account of soil so that they have water to draw on when they are being harvested. Now, the exact opposite thought was developed by our specialist in walnuts and almonds, Bruce Lampen. And what he found was that he would see symptoms in summer, in sort of June, July, of kind of yellowing and all kinds of other symptoms, distorted leaves, you know, leathery leaves, funny symptoms that he associated with the fact that these growers were starting to irrigate very early in the spring when the trees were still at the baseline value. So the trees were saying we're fine and the growers were irrigating. And some people say, you know, growers don't irrigate plants when the plants are stressed. They irrigate the plants when they are stressed. So it's May and hot, and so maybe these trees need water. So what we said was, hey, maybe that's the wrong way to go. Maybe what we need to do is actually wait in the spring to start irrigating until we see some indication that these trees are below their baseline value. So we're kind of letting the soil dry out a little bit. And of course, this was a study with lots of cooperators. So here's what happened that first year. When you look at the ET graph, so this is ET minus rain anyway, so that's it's kind of the water demand of the orchard. It gets close to 40 inches for a season, which is considered normal for walnuts. The grower matched that very closely through the season, which is fine. That's what the book says to do. Now, when we waited for one bar below, it didn't really make much difference. But if we waited for two or three or four bars, we were waiting for almost 2 months in some cases to start irrigating, just waiting for the trees to say, okay, now I'm a little bit dry or a little bit more dry. Now we thought that the four bar treatment might be a little bit too much, okay? But what was really interesting was at the end of that first year, we have the growers' trees and they match DT very closely, but the irrigation manager went out there and saw that our trees actually looked healthier than the grower trees at harvest. So in fact, it looks like the grower was shooting themselves in the foot by irrigating too soon. And it wasn't a question of putting more water in the bank account for the trees to use at harvest. It was a question of letting the soil dry out and the roots get healthy in order to tap into the water that was available at harvest, because these trees all looked really good. And in fact, they had less water stress at this time than these other trees. Okay, so that was 2014. What happened in 2015? Growers started waiting to irrigate, okay? Which kind of messed up our experiment, but we still, you know, had things to compare. Now, fast forward to today, we've had a number of these plots in Walnut, and averaged over all those plots and all those years, here's what we found. Compared to the ET of the orchard, which I think is a good estimate of the ET, we've confirmed it other ways, that's what the trees are using, that the growers are actually irrigating substantially less than that, and we are able to wait even longer, a month or more, to begin irrigating compared to when ET picks up. So we're hoping that this is going to be a practice. It seems to be taking hold already. But here's that's an example of where we start way after what ET would say, and we end up not even putting on what full ET is, just because the trees have access to water and they're going to use it, and it's a good idea to let them use it. Okay, is everybody okay with this? Any questions? Okay, we're doing good. That's an example of just saving water and accomplishing something good in the trees. But there's also the concept that actually some stress may be a good idea. Now, there's lots of crops where this is, and actually I would say things like processing tomatoes and even crops like wheat and so on, beans, they always have an irrigation cutoff at the end. This is not a new idea, but in almonds, there's a very particular period of development of the fruit that is that it's a good idea to have stress. So normally the almond fruit, you know, grows like this until the summer, and then it starts splitting, what's called splitting. And when the almond fruit splits, what you want to happen is that split develops quickly and the nut dries quickly. Otherwise, if there's a prolonged period of time when the almonds are splitting, then insects lay their eggs in here and you get all kinds of diseases and problems. So it turns out that if the trees are under mild or moderate stress during this time, during split, then this process goes faster. And in fact, the nuts get a little bit easier to harvest at the end. So, and that had already been proposed. So what we found after a while was if you measure 14 to 18 bars during hull split, that's a reasonable amount of stress. You know, baseline might only be 10 or 12 at this time. And that's what we recommended. So we had a situation where there was a grower up in Tehama that had different soils. And if you see this aerial photograph, you can kind of see the darker areas, this area here and this area here. And these darker areas are where the canopy was bigger, and they map almost exactly to the borders of some soil boundaries that were in this area. Now the grower they knew about this border. So they had already designed their irrigation system as one set here and another set here. But the problem the grower had was that the trees on the east side would always be way delayed in when they were splitting compared to the trees on the west side, even when they gave them the same amount of water. And this is a huge problem, okay? Because they have to time a spray for, well, you're organic growers, so I apologize for this, but they have to time a spray to inhibit the, you know, navel orange worm, which lays their eggs in those nuts at that time. And if one is, you know, 20% split or four, you know, and the other one's not split at all, then you can't spray and so on. So this was a huge headache. And The grower had already tried to modify his irrigation to try to get these things in line, but wasn't successful and didn't think it was working. And we said, well, let's measure the trees. Well, it turned out when we actually measured the trees in 2000, these trees were at baseline, and these trees were actually in the zone that we said was good for hull split. So we said, well, it's a simple problem. We just have to cut back on the water on these trees to get them in the same line. So what did we do? The next year, we cut back on the water and we got them exactly to march in synchrony with hull split. And we did that for a few years, okay? What was really surprising, however, was how much difference there was in how much water we put on. So this first year, we put on about half the water of ET, and we were able to cut the water back or cut it off in July, whereas the gravel trees were being cut off in August to prevent them from going into too much stress for an August harvest, more or less. The next year, we got a little carried away. We put on a whole lot less water and cut it off in the 1st of July. But then it turned out that we can put a little bit more water, but go all the way back to June before we start cutting back the water in the east side to make them split the same as the west side soil. So you see here, this is an example of how much difference in water and how much difference in water management will be required to adapt irrigation scheduling to different zones of soil. So what we found was, you know, if cutting back in June is almost like not starting to irrigate at all for those trees in that really good silt soil. Now, but what did we see? What we saw was we have the east side and the west side, and we had our own west side story, right? We had trees that were on the west side, on the east side, but they were growing on the west side soil. And you can kind of see that as this spot here. So this soil extended into here, but what the grower did to get rid of this effect was they just extended the irrigation lines over this far and then just divided the irrigation there. Now, I want you to see, though, that this soil difference can occur in a very short distance, one tree. Okay, you can see the difference between trees that are fine and trees that are starting to defoliate. Okay, so if you think of irrigation from the plant's perspective, then if you're dealing with young plants and you want them to grow, you know, maybe it's a good idea to think about more frequent irrigation. Not necessarily just more irrigation, but why are they stressed and when are they stressed and what do we need to do to get them to be not stressed if that's what we're trying to do? And that's where you need to measure water potential to find out, are you fine-tuning your irrigation frequently appropriately? When you have established plants, especially in trees and vines, and I think it also occurs in prune or things like processing tomato, wine grape, and so on, then you may have a direct benefit of some stress on some process. And you may have indirect effects of allowing the soil to dry out, maybe for root health. But the bottom line is, let's just not forget about the plant, what the plant is experiencing and what it's doing at the time and what you're trying to accomplish.